May the name of the Lord be exalted and glorified amidst us this evening. I really thank the Lord for the opportunity that He has given me to be part of this IBF conference. And it's my joy and privilege to be here to meet new people. And thank you for welcoming me into your midst. And I also want to really thank you all for giving me this privilege to share from God's Word. For our meditation this evening, we'll be looking at a very familiar passage or a very familiar event in the Old Testament. So please turn your Bibles to the book of Jonah, minor prophetical book of Jonah. Although this is a small book with just 48 verses, the book is mostly known for one of the most spectacular events in the entire scripture. That's Jonah being swallowed up by the whale or the great fish. But then when we begin to read this book very carefully, we realize the central focus of the book is not the great fish. It is not the great city, Nineveh, which is mentioned in the book. It is not even the prophet Jonah. The central or primary focus in the book of Jonah is the great God of the Bible. This little book reveals more of God, His nature, His character, and His ways, and more importantly, His great heart for the world. So this evening, it is my prayer and desire, as we meditate from this very familiar passage or very familiar book, the Lord would reveal Himself to us. We would know more of our God. We would know more of His great plans for each of our lives. We would know more of His heart's desire for the world in which we live. So that is my prayer and desire for all of us this evening. Our particular focus today will be from chapter 4, Jonah chapter 4. But before we get there, let me briefly highlight what we find in the first three chapters, just to refresh our memories. Chapter 1, God commands Jonah to go to the city of Nineveh and preach against it. But then Jonah is not at all interested in this mission. He goes on his way exactly in the opposite direction. Then when we come to chapter 2, God graciously intervenes in the life of Jonah. God disciplines Jonah by keeping him in the belly of the fish and eventually delivers him. So in the second chapter, the end of that, Jonah declares salvation belongs to the Lord. And then when we move to chapter 3, the word of the Lord comes second time to Jonah. The same commission is given to him. Go to the city of Nineveh and preach against it. And this time Jonah obeys God. He goes over to the city of Nineveh, the great city, and he preaches what the Lord had laid in his heart. And as a result of that, we see a great revival breaking out in the city of Nineveh. A revival which probably is unparalleled in history. When you look at the history of 19th and 20th centuries, we hear a lot of revival happenings all across the world. Men like Charles Finney or D.L. Moody or great evangelists like Billy Graham have been used in great revivals. But the revival that we see in chapter 3 is almost unparalleled in history. Because we read, the greatest to the least in that city were impacted by the preaching of this man. God brought them to repentance. Having gone through all these three chapters, then when we come to chapter 4, it's almost like an anticlimax. Instead of witnessing a man of God who is rejoicing or who is in great jubilance, praising God or thanking God for using him to accomplish greater things in the city of Nineveh, when we come to chapter 4, we are actually witnessing Jonah the prophet sulking, protesting, fuming with anger. And we're going to read a couple of verses. Jonah chapter 4, the first two verses. But it displeased Jonah exceedingly, and he became angry. And also going to read verse 3. Therefore now, O Lord, please take away my life from me, for it is better for me to die than to live. Jonah is not just angry and displeased. He's so bitter in his heart. He's so bitter, he just cannot take it. And three times in this chapter, Jonah expresses his desire to die. Now, as we look into this fourth chapter, we are facing a couple of questions here. Why did the prophet of God, who was so amazingly used by God in the previous chapter, what went wrong with this man? Why did the prophet of God behave in such a manner when we come to chapter 4? I believe Jonah's shocking behavior in the fourth chapter has to do with a couple of failures in Jonah's life. A couple of failures in his spiritual journey, in his understanding of God, in his relationship with God. And we're going to focus on those two failures, and with that we'll wind up our sermon this evening. Here is the first one. Jonah could not accept God's will and authority. Jonah could not accept God's will and authority. Now, when we read chapter 4, verse 2, we realize Jonah knew the character of God so well. Look at what he says. I know that you are a gracious and merciful God, slow to anger and abundant in loving kindness. Jonah is actually making this confession. Lord, I know that you're gracious. I know that you're loving. I know that you're merciful. Not just that, we realize he also knew how God would respond to people when they really repent. He also knew how God would respond to people when they really repent. Look at this phrase here. Look at this phrase here. The last phrase in verse 2. One who relents from doing harm. He also knew the way the Lord reacted or responded to the people of Nineveh. Yes, Lord, I know that you have such a heart that relents from doing harm when you see them come back to you. And the other thing that we find when we read the first couple of verses, we know that Jonah knew this was coming. He was anticipating this. He knew it was coming. If you look at the second verse, the beginning, the first part, "Oh Lord, was not this what I said when I was still in my country? Lord, I know that this is coming." And that is why I responded in that manner. For Jonah, it was not a lack of understanding. For him, it was not a lack of discernment. For Jonah, the precise problem was he just could not accept the Almighty's decision with regard to the people of Nineveh. He just could not accept what the Lord did to the people of Nineveh. According to Jonah, the Assyrians who lived in Nineveh, they only deserved to be destroyed. They were the enemies of God's chosen people, Israel. They were the ones who were taunting Israel for over these years. They were the ones who caused so much of trouble for God's people. They were cruel, they were wicked, they were violent. And therefore, according to Jonah, they deserve to be destroyed. Instead, God spared them, showed them his mercy and kindness, and Jonah just could not accept the fact. Probably, Jonah expected God to work according to his desires, according to his whims and fancies. If you clearly go through chapter 4, we realize Jonah is a man who is so much engrossed with his own self and selfish agendas. Now, if you just start counting the personal pronouns which Jonah is using in this conversation with God, words like me, my, I. You'll keep on counting that. Just look at these phrases. What I said, take my life. It is better for me to die. It is right for me to be angry. Here is a man who is totally engrossed in himself. Especially in his relationship with God, he cannot think beyond himself. A man who is so much engrossed with his own self and selfish agendas. Perhaps Jonah thought it was all about himself. It was all about himself. So we find, without any hesitation or remorse or any qualm, in chapter 4, Jonah openly tells the Lord, Lord, this is why I fled to go to Tarshish. Without any remorse, he's telling the Lord, I didn't like what you said. I didn't like the commission that you gave me. It was against what I desired. Therefore, I fled. Without any hesitation, he's saying, yes, I fled previously to Tarshish. Very interestingly, when we come to verse 5, we see the prophet of God waiting outside the city and wondering what would happen to the city of Nineveh. Perhaps in Jonah's mind, he probably thought, after the Lord was listening to his protest, God is going to change his mind. Perhaps God is going to destroy the city of Nineveh as he desired. Here is a man of God waiting outside the city to see the fulfillment of his desires. Jonah will not change his mind, or he will not change his attitude. Rather, he would want God to change his mind and his actions. In response to Jonah's behavior, the Lord asked him a couple of questions. And that's what I want to focus this evening. In response to Jonah's behavior, the Lord came closer to him and asked him a couple of thought-provoking questions. This evening, I do believe, although we live a few centuries after Jonah lived, and I do believe if you spend time before God's word, the same questions would be addressed to us. And if we give serious thoughts to those questions, I do believe the Lord has got something to share with each of us. The first question that's found in verse 4. Chapter 4, verse 4. Then the Lord said, is it right for you to be angry? Jonah, is it right for you to be angry? What's this anger all about? What's this sulking all about? What is this protest all about? Jonah, is it right for you to be angry? And then from verse 6 onwards, we find a small demonstration happening over there. God wanted to teach Jonah a very important lesson. So we find here is this man of God sitting outside the city, and there was so much of heat out there. The Lord provided him a plant that would grow up all of a sudden, provide him the shade that he needed. And that's the only time in the book of Jonah we read that this man of God was exceedingly glad. And that almost gives us a picture about the kind of man Jonah was. The only time that Jonah could rejoice was in the fact that there was shade over his head. There was little comfort or convenience over his head. Now, as we read, as we know, the very next day the Lord sent a worm, and then which ate up the plant. And by the time the plant was gone, man of God is again angry. This time he is so angry He's angry with the Lord. He's angry with the worm. He's angry with the plant. Anger. Again, the Lord comes to Jonah, whispering in his ears the same question. Jonah, is it right for you to be angry? Do you really have a cause or a valid reason to be angry? By asking this question, I believe the Lord wanted Jonah to know a very important lesson. The Lord was driving home one of the vital lessons of the scripture. And this is how I want to explain that to you. It's like God looking at Jonah and telling him, Jonah, I am God. I have the ultimate authority. I know what I'm doing. I will show mercy on those whom I will show mercy. I will have compassion on those whom I will have compassion. Jonah, I know what I'm doing to the people of Nineveh. And I do believe, if I'm allowed to rephrase this question, probably the Lord was standing close to Jonah and asking him, would you please allow me to be God? Jonah, would you please allow me to be God? I know what I'm doing. I do believe the entire book of Jonah seems to emphasize this vital lesson. God as the creator has got every right to command his creation to do anything that he has planned from eternity. The wind, the plant, the worm, the great fish, every creature that you find in the book of Jonah willingly submitted themselves to the authority and will of God. Except the man of God. Except Jonah, we find all other creatures willingly submitting themselves to God's ultimate authority. I do believe that Jonah's struggle could be our struggle too. In our walk with the Lord, in our Christian life, Jonah's struggle could be our struggle too. An unwillingness to yield our lives to the Lord's will and authority. Now, one of the things that Jesus talked to his disciples when he was going out and calling out his first disciples, one of the things that he made it very clear was this fact. If you want to follow me, he very clearly said, without mincing words, he said, let him deny himself. Let her deny herself. If you want to follow me, he laid the conditions without mincing words. Now, what is the meaning of denial of self? Now, some people think denial of self is the same as self-denial. But I want to tell you this evening, every religion in the world talks about acts of self-denial. Whether Hinduism or Islam or Buddhism or Jainism, almost every religion in the world promotes some acts of self-denial. Was Jesus just repeating that to his disciples? No. I do believe there's a world of difference between this almost seeming words, self-denial and denial of self. In acts of self-denial, it could be getting up early in the morning for prayer. It's something very good. It could be skipping a meal. It could be deciding to give your money regularly. It could be anything. Something that you decide to do or not to do. But remember, in all these acts of self-denial, it is you who decide. Jesus is certainly not talking about such acts. Denial of self. Now, this is how I want to explain that. We all have likes and dislikes. All of us who are here, irrespective of our backgrounds, irrespective of our ages, all of us, we have our own sets of likes and dislikes. From little things like what to have for breakfast, or what kind of dress to wear, to the more significant things in life. What kind of job should I get? What kind of person should I marry to? Or where should I live? What kind of house should I buy? In all these matters, I do believe all of us who are here, we all have a set of likes and dislikes. You know what it means when Jesus looked at his prospective disciples and said, if you want to follow me, deny yourself. Let him deny himself. Let her deny herself. This is what I mean. This is what I understand that Jesus meant. It's like going into the presence of God. If you are accepting the call that comes to you, if anyone wants to be my disciple, come unto me. If you are accepting the call, I just want to visualize this. Imagine that Jesus is there in a room and we have heard the call of God and we are entering into the room. And then as you approach Jesus, you hand over your list, which has got your likes and dislikes. And you hand over it to him. And then in exchange, you, when you walk out of that room, you carry with you a set of his likes and dislikes. And that is denial of self. It's a decision that we have already taken at the time we decided to invite Jesus into our lives. We have already decided, we have agreed that we will make him the Lord of our lives. But sadly, I should say that many Christians have lived probably decades together, 10 years or 15 years after conversion, not knowing the fact they have actually handed over the authority of their lives to this Jesus. This very particular thing, denying ourselves, this decision to hand over our life's authority to him is actually a very dangerous decision that many of us have already taken, with knowing or without knowing. Because this is going to affect every aspect of our life. You know what? Paul beautifully understood this when he wrote to 2 Corinthians, the second letter to Corinthian church, 2 Corinthians chapter 15 verses, chapter 5 verses 14 to 15, where Paul says, he died for all, therefore those who are now living, we no longer can live for ourselves. That's a great statement. Paul said, we can no longer live for ourselves, but for the one who gave himself for us. Do we really understand the depth of that? We have lost the right to live for ourselves. The moment we decided to give Jesus our lives, we have decided to lose any kind of freedom over our lives. As I said, sadly, many Christians have not understood this. C.T. Studd, a great missionary, a man who had given his life, his career, his wealth, all for the sake of the kingdom of God. C.T. Studd, towards the end of his life, he made a statement like this. He said, I know that Jesus died for me, but for a long time, I did not realize if Jesus died for me, I don't belong to himself. I don't belong to himself. If I don't belong to myself, then in reality, if I live for my own sake, I'm actually robbing God. I'm actually robbing God. My dear brothers and sisters, do we realize that we don't belong to ourselves? We belong to God twice. He is our creator. He has absolute authority over our lives. Secondly, he sent his only begotten son and redeemed us, bought us with a great price. He is our creator. He is also our redeemer. We belong to him twice. Therefore, we have lost the life, we have lost the right to live for ourselves. I want to ask you this evening. Can we say with real confidence? Can we say with utter truthfulness that we have been living a life where Jesus, in fact, really the Lord of our lives? Is he the one who is having the final say in all our matters? Is he the one who is having the final say in our families? Is he the one who is having the final say in our children's career or marriage? Is he the one who is having the final say in our life, real day-to-day life? I want to share with you a story that really warmed my heart several years ago. It really explains what I've been trying to tell you this evening. There was this teenage girl brought up in South Carolina in US, brought up in a Christian home. She gave her life to the Lord at a very young age. And then as she was growing up, she had her own dreams. The average American dream. She wanted to get married to a handsome man, have a nice farmhouse. In her description, she said she wanted to have a nice farmhouse facing rolling meadows with white fence all around her house. And then she wanted to be a nurse in the neighborhood. She wanted to have lots of kids playing all around in her house. That was a dream, average American dream. One day, there happened to be a missionary who visited her church. And this man was challenging the people over there, telling them very clearly that 90% of all Christians are actually working among 10%. They're working among 10% of unreached places. 90% of Christians have placed themselves among other Christians. And she was so challenged, she wanted to be part of that 10% who would go out anywhere into the world to work among unreached people. It so happened, soon she discovered the Lord was calling her to a faraway land, somewhere near Philippines, to work among a group called Balango tribe. And here she was. It was a huge struggle for her. On one side, all her cherished dreams, all that she has been dreaming about, making her life in the US, getting married to a handsome man, being part of a large farmhouse with a lot of children playing around, and all that. On the other side, now the Lord was calling her to a faraway land, not knowing where she was going, what kind of people she was going to work and all that. It took almost 3 months for her to come to a conclusion. One day, when she was about to go to bed, she opened her journal and wrote these words: "I let my dreams die. I let my dreams die." That became the title of the third chapter in a biography. The Lord used this average American girl who was willing to yield herself. It's not about her desires. She was willing to yield her desires to the Lord. The Lord took her to Philippines. She worked with the Wycliffe Bible translators. Last year, I had this great opportunity to meet her in person in Bangalore. She's now about 80 years old. A woman whose life has been entirely spent for the sake of the God who gave his life for her. I want to ask you this evening. I don't know in what areas of your life you have this struggle to yield yourself to the Lordship of Christ. It could be a very, very personal thing. But I do believe all of us, we are called to yield our lives under the Lordship of Christ. That's real walking with the Lord. In response to Jonah's behavior, that's what we are looking at. As I said, the Lord had his first question. Jonah, is it right for you to be angry? And he also had another question. And we'll look at that briefly and then we'll wind up. Chapter 4, verse 11. The last verse in the chapter. And should I not pity Nineveh, that great city, in which are more than 120,000 persons who cannot discern between their right and their left, and much livestock? Jonah's second failure, I believe, was this. He, like many of his contemporary brethren, could not understand God's great plans and purposes for this world. Jonah could not understand God's great plans and purposes for the world. Jonah thought that he and his people alone deserve to be God's chosen people. Like any other Israelite of his time, Jonah was so narrow-minded, so ethnocentric, so patriotic. He thought they alone deserve God's mercy and compassion. So therefore, when God now decided to extend his mercy and compassion to the Assyrian people who were living in Nineveh, Jonah just could not accept that. He just could not accept that fact. Now God was extending his kindness and his love even to the enemies of Israel. And I do believe Jonah's failure is also Israel's failure. I don't know how many of you have looked at the scripture that way. They failed to understand God's plan and purposes for the world. Now, why did God choose Israel to be his beloved nation? To be his chosen vessel, to be his treasured possession of all the nations in the world. Now we see that right in the call of Abraham. Genesis chapter 12, when God called Abraham, the first couple of verses we know, Abraham, I'm going to make your name great, your descendants will be great, all said and done. Finally, when the Lord concluded, he made it very clear, in and through you, all the families of the world will be blessed. Not just in the call of Abraham, my dear friends, my dear brothers and sisters. There are several verses throughout the Old Testament that talks about Israel's call to be a light to the nations around them. As we read in the book of Isaiah, they were called to be a lighthouse to the nations around them. God wanted to use them to draw other nations, other people groups to himself. But Israel failed. Israel failed. Israel only thought about their privileges. They only rejoiced in their privileges. They forgot about their responsibilities. They had become so narrow-minded and ethnocentric. And that's what we see in the life of Jonah. When God called him, and God wanted him to go to the city of Nineveh to be a source of help to those Ninevites, Assyrians over there. Jonah was not willing to do that. Now, you know what's happening here? The Lord comes closer to Jonah. He's opening up his heart and revealing himself to this man and to the God's chosen people. My heart is not just for you. Should I not be concerned about that great Assyrian people who are living in the city of Nineveh? Should I not be concerned about them? God was now opening up his heart and revealing a great desire to reach out to the peoples of the world. My dear brothers and sisters, for those of us who live in the New Testament, the mandate is very clear. It's been given to us with clear-cut terms. When Jesus, just before ascension, he called his disciples and gave this great commission. Go therefore and make disciples of all nations. The word which is used there is panta ethne, which means every people group. And I do believe that is the desire of the Lord. He wants to see every people group represented in the heaven. I also want you to keep one thing in your mind. If you want this to excite you the rest of your life, I want you to keep one more vision in your mind. That's the picture we see in the book of Revelation. Revelation chapter 5, verse 9, we read, from every nation, from every tribe, from every language, there'll be a great multitude of people. You know what? That will be the greatest moment of God's glory. That will be the greatest moment of God's glory. History is moving towards that. History is not a set of random events. Whether we are going to join with him in accomplishing this or not, one day what we read in the book of Revelation is going to become a reality. From every people group, there'll be a worshiping community. The question that I want to place before you is this evening, are you excited to be part of what the Lord is doing in the world? Sometimes, no, we can all become so inward looking. We can be so satisfied with our Sunday meetings. We can be so satisfied with our weekday meetings. We can be satisfied with our Bible studies. We can be satisfied with our conferences. But let me remind you, humbly this evening, all these are not an end in themselves. I want to ask you, this is something that I've been asking wherever I go. When was the last time your local church was willing to send a missionary? When was the last time a conference or a meeting ended up sending missionaries, fulfilling God's heart's desire? These are some serious questions we need to think about. Every child of God needs to be gripped by these two pictures. One is the Great Commission. The other one is the great grand finale, the vision of the grand finale that we see in the book of Revelation. You know what? For that to become a reality, from every nation, from every tribe, from every language, for that to become a reality, my dear friends, there's still a lot to be done. 29% of world's population is yet to hear the name of Jesus. Whether you like it or not, 29% of world population, they have no access to this living gospel. Years back, Oswald J. Smith, a great missionary statesman, he made this statement. He said, we're talking about Christ's second coming, but half of the world has not heard about his first coming. Half of the world has not heard about his first coming. Praise God. Praise God, that figure has come down. 29% of world's population today have not heard the gospel. I praise God for what our brother was sharing with us this evening. But I want to humbly remind you, there are still more than 2,100 people groups right there within India, all spread across. 2,100 people groups who have never heard the gospel of Christ. What can we do about this? Will we outsource this work to a group of people and then feel very happy about it? Are we going to say, okay, we've been funding some mission agencies, we have been giving money to some missionaries, our work is over? No. We need to be seriously concerned about what is the Lord's heart's cry. For the task of world evangelization, to be completed. The need of the hour is a bunch of people. Let me say this, I say with all sincerity today, what the world needs today, the need of the hour is a bunch of people who would be willing to throw away their lives for this cause, for this one cause, world evangelization. There were a couple of centuries like that. 19th century and 20th century, men and women of God, not ordinary people. If you look at some of their profiles, it's mind-blowing. Men who graduated, men and women who graduated from prestigious institutions like Oxford, Cambridge, Princeton, Yale universities. People who said, we want to reach out to the world. We want to take the gospel to those places where it has not been preached before. Hundreds, thousands of people from North America and also from Europe and from England, they swept across. They swept across like bees, swarm of bees, with this one mission. We want to see God glorified among the peoples of this world. Is that our heart's desire? Is that our heart's desire? And I'm going to close here. And I want to close here with the illustration of a man whose life has been a challenge to me. There was this veteran missionary who had served the Lord in India, part of Calcutta, for very many years. And when he was old, he had to return back to his native country, Scotland. Although he had returned back to Scotland, his heart was still really beating for India. He loved the people of India so much. When he started his ministry in India, he realized India needed Christ. People in India, they needed education. They needed civilization. They needed the gospel. Gospel alone could transform this nation. So he worked in India for several years. Now he was back in Scotland. Although he was back in Scotland, as his heart was still for India, he went around preaching in churches, motivating young people to take up the cause of mission in India. One day there was a large gathering in his local church, Presbyterian church. And this man, veteran missionary, although he was aged, with all his vigor, he was making this appeal for the nation of India. He said something like this: many of us have come back from India. We are now old. We need people who could replace us. India is still open. India still needs you. And as he was giving this appeal, he said something like this. When people were not moved by what he was saying, he looked at those crowd and said, he looked at the young people mainly and said, when Queen Victoria calls young people to serve in the army, hundreds of you are willing to go. But the King of Kings, the Lord of Lords, when he wants young people to go out for him, nobody wants to go. There was still silence. And now he focused his attention on the old people, the aged people who were there. He looked at them and said, with lots and lots of humility and beseeching them, he said, are there not any more fathers and mothers in Scotland who are willing to give their children for the sake of India? As he was giving this appeal, he collapsed and fell onto the ground. A doctor immediately attended to him. And when this old man opened his eyes, he asked them, where am I? What am I doing? They said, you just had a mild heart attack. We want you to be quiet for some time. This man said, I have not finished my appeal. Take me back to the pulpit. With two people, one on each side, they brought this old man, weak old man, to the pulpit. And he continued his appeal. You know what he said? And the crowd was not willing to commit themselves. When both young and old sat there with indifference, you know what this old man said? Well, I am old. I'm aged. But still, it's fine. Take me back to the land of India. Put me somewhere on the banks of River Ganges. Let the people of India know there was at least one man in Scotland who was willing to give his life for the nation of India. My dear brothers and sisters, if you're wondering about whom I'm talking this evening, if you have been through an English medium school in India, if you or your parents or children, if they had this great privilege of going through an English educational system, it was because of this one missionary by name Alexander Duff. One man who wanted to share the blessings that he received with the people of India. Today, where are our children? Where are our children? Where are our young people? Why are they not willing to give their lives for the sake of taking the gospel to unreached places of the world, to see God glorified? We need to seriously think about it. My dear church, my dear friends, brothers, sisters, we need to seriously think about it. And I do believe these two things that I've been talking about this evening, one has to do with discipleship. One has to do with our understanding of who our God is. We need to come under the Lordship of Christ on a day-to-day basis. We need to give ourselves to Him unconditionally. And then I'm sure God would open out His heart. He would speak to us His desires. And then as a result of that, His name will be glorified all over the world. May the Lord give us grace to lead such lives. We'll close with a word of prayer. Father, we thank you for being with us during this conference. Thank you for your presence. Thank you for the living word that you have entrusted into your hands. I want to thank you for the wonderful lessons that we could learn from the book of Jonah. We looked at a couple of failures that happened in the life of Jonah. He could not yield himself to your authority. He was engrossed in his own self and selfish agendas. Lord, we pray that you would deliver us from such lives. Father, we pray that we would really yield ourselves to the Lordship of Christ in our day-to-day walk of life. Father, I also pray that you would open up our hearts and minds to know your heart's desire, to know what you really want to do in the world. Lord, help us to channelize our energy, our time, our money, our skills and gifts for that purpose. I want to thank you for your presence amidst us this evening. Continue to minister to us. Bless our time together. In Jesus Christ's name we pray. Amen.